in strength, whatever it is, build up your heart. God can give you what you need.
Amen.
And if you don't listen to the preacher, don't pay no mind to what the Word of God says, and then they'll do good. I can always have that in mind. If you've never heard of it before, pray for it. But Randy be a prayer for him as a kind. Go ahead.
Amen.
God bless. Hey, we're sure thankful to be back tonight. Rather be here than possible.
Amen.
Matter of fact, I'd rather be here than anywhere else I know. Because we're God's people.
Yeah.
I believe the Lord has made a way for each one of us together here tonight. Boy, if you're where the Lord wants you, you're in a good place.
Amen.
Really are.
Yeah.
Tell Steve and Heather and all the family how much Martin and I appreciate them. But I stopped there a while ago. I don't know how people can be so close and live so far away. We live about 500 miles.
Amen.
Bless them. But they're just like their family. Just show us a lot of kindness.
There you go.
And we should thank for that. Thank God for the opportunity to come up this way and bless you all.
Thank God for
to meet some new friends, to meet some that we had met before when we were up here. And, I tell you what God does for us is it's just wonderful.
Yes, it is.
You know, a lot of you I've met, I'll never forget you.
Bless
you. As long as I live, because the Spirit of God is very witness.
Amen.
And I know that we're brothers and sisters in Christ.
Amen.
And so I just want to thank you for that. I thought there a while ago, I felt myself just, you know, when it's cold and dark, and you got a good warm fire built, and you just move up to that fire and just feel that heat and how good it is. And I thought that's the way the Spirit of God is. When the Spirit starts moving, and we'll just move up to that fire, turn the cup up where we can get what the Lord wants for us. And they just ain't nothing like it.
Amen.
Well, I'm right where I've been every night this week. Can't do nothing without the Lord.
Yes.
Just looking for His help once again and asking for your all's prayers. I can't be a help to you. I'm sure I'm going to be a hurt to you.
Amen.
And by the grace of God, I'm not going to be a hurt to you. You know, I love to attend on you. I won't be in the book of Nehemiah tonight. It's where the Lord has put on his heart. I just sort of wait around and make sure that's where I've been praying on and reading and looking at today. Take a little bit of time there to make sure that we're going to be in the fourth chapter. This has always been a blessing, very, very special scripture to me. It's just, I don't know, it seems like there's some scripture that's easier for me to understand get things out of than other scripture. It's not that there's anything wrong with any of the scripture, but it seems like I just get a beautiful picture here in Nehemiah of the church. But I also thought, and I never saw this till today, but I also got a picture of Nehemiah resembling Christ. Have you ever saw that in the Nehemiah, that's in the Christ? Now, you know, Christ is Christ. He's Jesus, can come, you know, and there's no other, don't get me wrong, but, you know, Nehemiah was in the palace, and he was the king's cupbearer.
Yeah.
And he was in a pretty good position.
Yeah.
So if you remember, in the scripture, before anybody could stand before a king, he had to be in pretty bad burn good shape.
Yeah.
You couldn't come before the king in just any old clothes or dirty or nothing like that. You had to be, look proper and clean. When they brought Joseph out of the dungeon down there to stand before Pharaoh, he had to change clothes and had to shave and he had to get cleaned up to be presented before the king.
Amen.
In a sense, that's the way we are, right?
Amen.
Yeah. We're dirty.
Yeah.
Filthy and sinful. Bless. But Jesus cleans us up.
Amen.
Makes us a fit such.
Yeah.
We can stand before the king, even though we've seen him, but we can stand before him just like we've never seen him because of the blood.
Amen.
That's what it's been said. But Nehemiah, and I don't want to get into the scripture here in a minute, but I want to lay this part out. But Nehemiah, as good a shape as he was in there with the king, he chose to leave all of that. Now the children of Israel was in great affliction and reproach back in Jerusalem, but Nehemiah chose to leave the position he was in, the good place he was in, and go back to Jerusalem with his brothers and sisters.
That's right.
That's what happened to Christ. Christ was on his throne in heaven, and the Bible says that he was rich, but he became poor that you and I might be rich.
Yeah. Right.
So he left all of his treasures in heaven and came to this earth to seek and to save that which was lost, and I'm one of them.
Yeah.
And he came to seek and to save that which was lost. Okay, now please pray with all your heart. And the fourth chapter, and we want to read the sixth verse, and then we'll just see what the Lord's got in store. It says, so built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the height thereof, for the people had a mind to work. And that's the verse that the Lord brought to us, and what we needed to look at tonight. The people had a mind to work. Now, the mind is an amazing thing. It's just an amazing thing, the mind is, and how that the mind works. And if you'll look at the scripture, you'll find in the scripture many times and many places that the mind is mentioned. And Peter said, I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance.
Yeah.
And what he was doing was causing them by their mind to remember where they'd been and what God had done for them.
Amen.
And reminding them of the scripture, of prophets and the apostles. And you know, just the word of God reminded them of that. And he said, I stir up your pure mind by way of remembrance. So God's children has got a pure mind.
Yeah.
But then we see that there is a corrupt mind also. We see in the scripture where in the book of Romans, where the scripture teaches us that when people didn't attain knowledge of God, in other words, when they didn't keep God in their mind, and that he turned them over to a reprobate mind, or a corrupt mind. And a corrupt mind, they don't even know what's up and down, or they don't know what's good and what's evil or what's right or wrong. And wouldn't you hate to be that way today, to just have a corrupt mind and not even know what's right or what's wrong? I thank God, Steve, for his Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And I thank you.
Bible says also that he's not given to us again the spirit of fear, but he's given us a love and power and a sound mind. So when he saved us by his marvelous grace, he gave us a sound mind and a pure mind. And I'm thankful that we've got that. Now, here in Nehemiah, and let me, as we're just sort of waiting on the Lord to just get us started here, but let me share this with you. A few weeks ago, or months, probably months now, I don't know, but the Lord enabled me to preach on the mind at church where I pastor, and my granddaughter back here, now 11 years old, and she was coming home from church a few weeks later, and she said, "Pap," said, "do you remember when you preached on the mind the other night?" And I said, "Yes, I do." And I preached on a willing mind is what I preached on. And she said, "Well, I've been thinking about that." And she said, "But I've been thinking about a determined mind." Now, you think that God can't use children now. And she had been thinking about a determined mind. And she said, "What I've been thinking about, Pap, and I've got a plan," she said. Her dad and mom has been divorced, and they're both out of church right now. And she said, "My plan is to lay my dad's clothes, his church clothes, out on the bed every Sunday morning, and then ask him to go to church with me." And I thought, you're talking about a determined mind on a little 11-year-old girl. Now, see, we just need to have that, don't we? As pastors and as preachers, every time we preach the Word of God, or every time we come to the house of God, we're not going to get to shout the house down. And we're not going to get to see somebody saved every time we come to the house of God. But God help us to have a determined mind to just, no matter what happens, to just keep loving the Lord and just keep serving Him. Joshua, I think it was, he had purpose in his heart. And he said, "As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord." Amen. I can't help some people, but some people I can't. Amen. And I love to help people, don't you? God's put that in my heart. And I tell you, I'd rather help somebody is to eat when I'm hungry. Amen. But I've tried to help some folks, and they just wouldn't let me. You know what the Bible says about that? It says to shake off the dust of your feet and to just go on your way. I think also about Jesus telling the disciples that he would make them fishers of men. Amen. And they was to go out like they used to catch fish, and they was to catch men instead of fish. Amen. Well, what you do, if you fish in one place and you don't catch nothing, well, you just go somewhere else. Amen. And try it again. Now, we can't change bait because the bait, amen, is the Word of God. We just got to stand on the Word of God and just keep fishing with the Word of God, and somewhere down life's way, somebody will buy it. Amen. They will take of it. Amen. And so all we've got to do, and I'm just not that determined about natural fishing. I used to go with my brother's son, and we went down North Lake one winter, and it was about 20 degrees, and he went flying down that lake, and tears running down my eyes, and I don't know what kept him from freezing. I'm going down that, and I said, "Lord, if you'll let me get back home, I'll never be in this boat again with him." And to this day, I've never went fishing with my brother again, because he was but God help me to be determined to just keep preaching the word of God. Most of my life, God turned it around. remember, now, it ain't no easy road.
No.
Now, I'm telling you, it's a rough kid. I went to a church one time.
Bless him.
And I stood. Man, I tell you what, I was driven, don't know what happened. I guess my faith, doubt, you know, probably.
Bless you.
I mean, I'm telling you, when I left that church, when I got out of that pulpit, service was over. I felt lower than a snake's bell.
Yeah.
I stayed in the Word. I know it stayed in the Word. But I'm telling you, I was lower than a snake's bell.
Yeah.
And we got out and got in the car and headed back home. And you know what I told Marty? I said, Marty, you know what I feel like I need to do? And she said, what? I said, I feel like I need to go back down there and apologize to them people. That's how low I felt. And when I got home and we got steps in the deck there, and it's pretty high off to the sort of the side of the house there. And I walked up them steps and up on that deck, and I had my Bible in my hand. And the old devil said, you slang that Bible down through that field just as fur as you can slang it, and you just forget about preaching. You know what I done? I didn't slang the Bible. Amen. Because I know it was the truth. I know it is the only hope I had, Tyler. Amen. So I went to my altar and I asked God to forgive me for that foolish thought. And I picked my Bible up and I just went right on to preach the next time. And that ain't the only time that I have left the pulpit feeling lower than a snake's belly. But who am I to grumble about that? Our Savior shed His blood for me. So what I'll do by the grace of God is just keep preaching. Amen. I've seen them turn sideways in the sea. Look out the window, grab a songbook and fiddle through it. Do anything to keep from hearing the Word of God. But I also see those faces back there aglowing with the Spirit of God on them. I just want to eat from the table of God. And that just keeps me going on.
Amen.
You believe what you want to believe. Jesus, when He fed the 5,000, He didn't give that bread to them people. He gave that bread to the disciples, and the disciples gave it to the people. Let me tell you, He's still giving the bread of life to men. What about women? Amen. You believe that? You ought to. But I don't see in the Scripture nowhere where God called a woman to preach. Amen. You just stay in your place and God will bless you, and let the men stay in their place and God will bless them.
Amen.
I tell them over church, if they want a woman preacher and you prospect church, they better get them another pastor. Because I won't put up with it.
Boy, that would be a sermon of some probably.
And it's a word.
Yeah.
Word.
Amen. Right.
It's a word. Nehemiah, when he prayed and God gave him favor with the king, and God told him what to ask for, he asked for letters. I thought about this when you stopped me a while ago. He asked for letters to get him from where he was. When he crossed the river, he was going to have to go through different countries down through there. And they had different rulers or governors over them countries. And if he had the authority to do what he was fixing to do, they would have stopped him. And you said that you didn't have no authority to do what, but you did, didn't you? And Steve ain't the one give you that authority up there, but it was the Holy Spirit of God. Amen. And them letters give him the authority Now listen to this. I heard something there. Amen. I believe the Spirit speaketh expressly, not only that. Amen. I believe if Jesus perceived the thought of their heart, I believe we can too. Amen. But now, the Bible says that there are many spirits, but one Spirit of God. And he said, try the spirits, amen, to see if they're of God. Amen. I don't think there's nothing wrong with just waiting out there a little bit and trying the spirit. Amen. But if it ain't that good, sweet Holy Spirit, you better back up and leave it alone, because it's going to do her. But if it's that good Holy Spirit of God, go with her. Amen. Church, and it will edify the church. Amen. The old mother church needs edifying.
Amen.
So he had the authority to turn. You bless my heart, brother. I'll tell you this. I appreciate you. Oh, Lord. Oh. He had the authority.
Yeah.
Nehemiah also asked for letters for the king's forest. He knew what he was going to have. The doctor had showed him that when he got down there. And he had everything ready when he got there. But now let me tell you, I'm telling you what, if God be for us, who be against us? Amen. That's what we got to look at, man. If God be for us, who in the world can be against us? Now, I know they'll raise up against us, but they ain't got no hope. Amen. There is victory in Jesus. Amen. And we're going to win. Amen. I might suffer a lot of persecution, and I might get my feelings knocked off my shoulders more than once. But by the grace of God, I'm just going to keep going on. I'm just going to go on for the honor and glory of the Lord. And I can't help what nobody else does.
That's right.
Let them do what they got to do. And God help us as His children to do what we got to do.
Amen.
He started on His way there. And the scripture says, now He did. Now Nehemiah, all he asked for was the letters to get him to Jerusalem. And he asked for the letters to King's Forest.
Yep.
And you know what? The king sent captains.
Amen.
Sent his soldiers with him. Amen. How many times have you asked for something and God gave you just double more than what you asked for? I'm telling you what, he's the most wonderful, the most precious. He's all in all. Amen. He's everything to you and I today. And if we'll just stay with Him, I'll guarantee you He will stay with us.
Yeah.
He said, I'll never leave you.
That's right.
I'll never forsake you. I know He never left me, but I left Him. I walked out in this old world saved as an 11-year-old boy. And let me share this with you. I'll try to get on back into that scripture. But I'm going to be honest with you. If I'd have been the Lord, I'd have not saved myself. Did you know that? The way I was. But let me tell you. The Lord knew when I was 11 years old, He knew what I was going to do.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
He knew that.
That's right.
Amen.
He knew, Kenny, I was going to fail him.
Yeah.
He knew as a teenager that I was going to walk right out of that Sunday school room and out of church and the ungodly things that I've done. My life. He knew that.
Yes.
And you know what He did? He saved me anyway.
Amen.
He saved me anyway.
Amen.
Bless the
Lord.
He saved us.
Amen.
Anyway. Knowing how we're going to fail. Knowing we're going to mess up. Have you ever read in the book where He threw the clay away? Amen. I've read that He's the potter and we're the clay. And I've read where He just makes out of us what He wants to make out of us. And sometimes He's got to break the vessel and just start over again. But I've never seen in the Oh.
Bless him, Lord.
He got down there. And he didn't tell nobody what God had put on his heart. But he got down there in 3 days and 3 nights. I thought of the resurrection. Boy, the walls were fixing to come from there, wasn't it? Amen. But 3 days and 3 nights, he went out there and he went over Jerusalem and he looked at all the rubbish and the gates burned with fire, all the stones tore down, and he looked at all of that. And for 3 days, and that tell nobody nothing. And then he came to the elders, and he started revealing them to them the vision that God had given him and the work God had given him to do there. And you know what they said? They said, let's just go to work. Amen. But you know what they had to do? The Bible says, and they strengthened their hands for the good work. Amen.
He mocked.
He made fun of you. He didn't know.
That's right.
he didn't understand. He thought it was just foolish, you know. But I tell you what, he prayed two or three times, and he heard the gospel.
Amen.
And the gospel pricked his heart.
Amen.
And you know what? He started asking them foolish people, what I need to do to be saved.
Amen. 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 You just let them come in. I don't care who they are. I don't care where they've been or what they've done. You let them come in here, amen, and you show them love, which I know you do, Steve, and you preach the gospel to them, and I tell you, God will take care of it. His word is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. Amen. And is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Amen. That word, you know, I thought about that two-edged sword. Why is it two-edged? Amen. Because it'll cut, and when it comes out, amen, it'll heal. If you let, and then he'll heal you.
Amen.
Amen.
Bless you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Glory.
Nehemiah. Oh, help me. They started mocking him, didn't they?
Yeah.
And making fun of him.
Yeah.
And you know what I see in this? The more they done, and the farther along they got, the madder the devil got.
Yeah.
Did you notice that? To start with, the scripture says that they had indignation against them for even being out.
Yeah.
And then when he said they started work on the wall, then they got mad.
Yeah.
Amen.
And then when they seen half of the wall was put together, they got even madder.
Yeah.
And they first started mocking them, and then they came out to fight them and to destroy them, but God was with them.
Amen.
What was the enemy going to do? Amen. Amen. If God was with them, God knowed every move they was making, every thought they was thinking, and they just couldn't wait. Let me tell you, the devil can't wait unless you just give in and give it to him. Don't give him what God's blessed you with.
Amen.
Hold on to that.
Yeah.
You hold on to that.
Amen.
With all your might.
Bless you.
And all the Lord's might. You hold on to it. I'm telling you, it's the most precious thing you've got on this earth. You might have a wonderful home, praise God for it. You might have the most expensive automobile that ever was, thank God for it. But I'm telling you what, He's giving you right there inside of you, and the Holy Spirit of God to lead and guide you. There's nothing in this world that can compare to that.
That's Lord God. Amen.
So, and I can't go through all this. I can't even think of it. It's just too much. Let me just touch some high spots here with the Lord's help. I don't want to tar you, but I want to feed you with the Word of God. I'll tell you what, I'm just so thankful. You know what I feel like I need to do? I feel like I need to write you a check, oh boy, for about $10,000 for even letting me come up this way. I tell you, I can just hug your neck, Steve. What a blessing you are to me. You and Heather and all the kids, I owe you so much. Hey, man, to call me up here, a little old stump job in Tennessee, boy, to come up here and get to be with you all.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, my goodness. Amen.
Bless the Lord.
Now listen. I don't want to scare you now, but Paul preached all night one time. You remember that? Amen. You remember? The old fella, he took all he could take. Finally, he went to sleep and fell out the window. But it didn't hurt him. The fall went down and he rose up. Amen. So a little word of God and going a little longer than you think, it ain't going to hurt you. That's just
eating. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Told Elijah, says, rise and eat. The journey's too long. Amen. We need this.
Amen.
I tell you, I do.
Amen.
Let's hope I can take a little over back to Tennessee when I go. Oh, my goodness.
Whew. We're watching football. They need money going on.
Amen.
Yeah, we lay up going overtime.
But they made fun. They made fun of me. They said, and you know who these people were? I looked at it today. These was no other than the ancestors of Lot. The Ammonites. That was the ancestors of Lot. And I thought about that. When Abraham and Lot was together, that burned Lot was before on his side all the way through the place.
He was.
And now then, here it is hundreds of years later, and that burnt his kids and a thorn in the church's side. You know, there's folks like that in this world.
Amen.
And they start out being a thorn in somebody's side. Some old preacher there with the love of God in his heart just trying to preach the Word of God and serve God. And folks just be a dang thorn in his side.
Yeah.
And then they raise their children up to be the same thorn. Amen. We need to raise our children up to just love people. Amen. Instead of trying to be a stumbling block and a thorn in their side. What's wrong with that? Just let the love of God abound in you. Amen. And just love one another. The scripture says that we need to be of one mind. Amen. It says, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. Amen. That's the mind we need. And we can all be together in this
world. Amen.
I thought of what some of them said this week, talking about how I know Jay, you know, I'm familiar with him, and there was another preacher here last night from another church. And somebody said there was four or five different churches represented. I mean, I don't know, you know. But I thought of that too, how they had come in to help you. And you know, on the wall, when they was building the wall, they was all kinds of different families, the tribes, you know, different families. And they were scattered out on that wall. And every family had a certain part of that wall that they needed to build. And let me tell you, you've got a certain wall, part of the wall you need to raise to. If you've been saved by the grace of God, God's put you somewhere. And if you're not there, He's got a place for you. And did you know it? I swear it just keeps coming. Now, Isaac, you remember Isaac, and when Abraham died, the Philistines stopped all the wells up that he had dug. But when Isaac got married and owned up in life, he went and redug the wells that Abraham had dug. And every time he did one, the Philistines would come and stop it up. He just let them have that and go dig another. Amen. But finally it come to the point they quit striving with it. Let me tell you, the old man, just endure and keep going, them old thorns will finally get torn, and they'll just go somewhere else. And if I say they cannot, then they're not satisfied. So you just keep serving the Lord, and finally they'll go somewhere else. God moves them out.
I've
seen him do it. He likes to move them out. Isaac, when they didn't strive, that was the third one, wasn't it? Anyhow, I'm thinking it was. When he didn't strive first, he said, the Lord has made room for us.
Amen.
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 Let me tell you, the Lord's made room for you in the church.
Amen.
He has.
Yep.
He's made room for you. He's got a place for you. I don't know who you are, and I don't know what it is.